untapped talent, diversifying through fair chance hiring. My name is Damani Fisher, Regional Director of Special Projects for the Bay Area Community College Consortium and an affiliate of the California Community College Rising Scholars Network, one of the co-sponsors of this event. We are honored to have as our co-sponsors three incredible organizations, the Anti-Recidivism Coalition and the CROP Organization and Checker, a business who is a leader in fair chance work. The theme for today's webinar is Deep Dive. We have three goals for today. Number one, to educate employers about opportunities for more intensive fair chance training. Number two, to share opportunities about programs that provide training and education to formerly incarcerated people from which employers can recruit qualified candidates who can add value to the workforce. And number three, to have a more in-depth discussion related to specific topics. We'll also link to an evaluation form to collect your feedback about this event. This program will be recorded and made available to you or to anyone else who may not have been able to attend. Here to deliver opening remarks for today's webinar is Kelly Nadler. Kelly has long been involved in efforts to expand access to education and training to systems impacted people. From 2018 to 2020, Kelly directed a statewide systems change initiative that increased higher education opportunities for incarcerated and formerly incarcerated Californians. In her current role as regional coordinator for the California Community College Rising Scholars Network, Kelly continues to provide critical support to colleges serving this population. I've had the honor of working with Kelly Nadler for the past 2 years now, and I believe I speak for many of my colleagues in the field when I say that Kelly's support for both our prison and campus-based programs has been absolutely critical to helping sustain momentum and progress toward our goal of providing all Californians equal opportunity to education. Without further delay, here is Kelly Nadler.
Thank you so much, Damani. It's an honor to be with you and with everyone who is attending today. So I'm so happy to be able to be here and to represent the sort of newly named Rising Scholars Network. As Damani sort of alluded to, our community colleges have really been working to support incarcerated and formerly incarcerated Californians since about 2015, with a few doing work prior. So when I joined this work in 2016, I was able to work to really support and scale these programs throughout California. The network itself is really comprised of a diverse group of professors, counselors, college administrators, college presidents, collegiate staff, formerly incarcerated student leaders, and currently incarcerated students in California. We are all dedicated and driven by a shared commitment to supporting students' access and success to the California Community College system. I think it might be helpful to just talk a little bit about the scale of the programs happening in California right now. We are offering transferable degree-granting courses to more than 12,000 students who are incarcerated in California's prisons, jails, and juvenile facilities. That number is an underestimate, right? We actually serve more and more students each semester, and we have so many incarcerated students on degree pathways so that when they are returning home, they may transfer out to a four-year institution or go straight into the workforce. Others who may remain inside are getting expanded access to bachelor's programs in our prisons. In addition to the work that the network does inside correctional facilities in California, we also have a growing support network on our college campuses. The California Community College system is one of the largest public higher education institutions in the world. We serve over 2 million students, and we have just a growing number of colleges, over, I think, 116 now. So it's really important to know that 50 of those colleges host support programs and on-campus student clubs that are dedicated to the success of our formerly incarcerated students. This looks different at each campus, but there's a lot of peer support networks being developed, a lot of hiring formerly incarcerated students and leaders in the state to run these programs and to be mentors to new students coming home. Just for visual effect, it's probably helpful to see the growth that California has experienced in the last 7 years. This map is just representative of 2014. And while it's probably hard to see, the point is there are very few dots on this map, right? This is representing that we had one prison with face-to-face college. We had one CSU Project Rebound program, and we had about 10 on-campus support programs throughout the three higher education institutions in California. Looking at 2021, this map is just of the community college system, representing the 34 of the 35 state prisons that we're teaching ADT transferable degree pathways in, representing the over 50 campuses that we have the support programs for our formerly incarcerated students on. And so just really understanding this massive scale that we're working with and thinking about the growth that's happened and that is continuing to happen into the future is really important. Another thing I just hope that we can take away from this map is that a new workforce is growing here, right? A new untapped talent pool comprised of people who have experienced or who currently are experiencing incarceration is growing and growing in our state. These people are on pathways, we always say, from CTE to PhD, which just means that we're going to support any student with any academic or career goal that they may have, whether it be to go into a career technical education trade or whether they want to become a long-term academic and PhD programs. And so just please know that you have this really diverse and really expansive and expanding talent pool that you may sort of reach into when looking for new employees. From our perspective, serving incarcerated and formerly incarcerated students is just a critical matter of equity. You know, we really stand on elevating individuals, their families, and our communities who are all impacted by the devastations of mass incarceration. So these programs that we're building are really comprised of our own high expectations for ourselves and our students and high student supports, really, because we have an intention of building a new generation of graduates, a new generation of leaders in our communities, and a new generation of leaders in our workforce. And this is really where we need you. We need the employers. We need those who are helping graduates obtain gainful employment to understand our students, to understand that we are out here, we are growing, and to understand that there is deep value in connecting with this network. It's been such an honor to work with the folks who have been collaborating on this webinar. We have fantastic people lined up to talk today who are all coming together with a shared mission. And I'm so honored to be able to bring the Rising Scholars Network and to bring the community college system, who has really been carrying the burden of leading the nation really in this work. California leads the nation in supporting incarcerated and formerly incarcerated students. And the brunt of that effort has been carried by these beautiful California college, community college practitioners. So as employers, as folks who are helping, you know, connect graduates to gainful employment opportunities, we would really hope that you could connect with us. We really hope that you consider our students, this new, this growing untapped pool of talent. You can connect with and recruit from local Rising Scholars programs. I've linked to our website here. There's a directory with an interactive map, so you'll be able to determine what programs are local to you. There's a contact person for each program. And then there's also, here is my email contact. There are three regional coordinators in the Rising Scholars Network in the state. And so I cover sort of down through the Salinas Valley, through the Greater Bay Area, and then anything north of Sacramento. But there are two others who represent the rest of the state, and their contact information is also going to be on our Rising Scholars website. So reach out to us. This is our full-time job. You're never bugging us. Really expanding opportunities for our students is what keeps us going every day. So with that, I'm going to pass it over back to Damani, and thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Kelly Nadler. Next, we want to transition to a segment that we're calling resource sharing. We have several community partners who would like to share information with you regarding programs that are designed for employers to learn more about Fair Chance Hiring And then we also have an organization represented here that will talk more about reskilling and upskilling opportunities for formerly incarcerated people. I have the pleasure to introduce Ann Parmeter, who's representing Dave's Killer Bread Foundation. And she's gonna be talking about a workshop designed for employers.
Fantastic, thanks so much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ann Parmeter, and I'm working with the Dave's Killer Bread Foundation. Can anyone enter in the chat if you are familiar or have heard of the Dave's Killer Bread Foundation? I am curious. So Dave's Killer Bread Foundation started about 7 years ago. As you may know, Dave's Killer Bread has been hiring people with conviction histories for decades. And only in the last few years have we started supporting our peers with training about how they can also embark on second chance employment, which, as you may or may not know, is the intentional practice of employing people who have a criminal background. So let's see, how many of you have heard of this work? A good number of you? Oh, fantastic. Okay, so we have some exciting opportunities going on right now. Just last week, we finished an 8-week program called the Second Chance Corporate Cohort. And this is where people from different organizations are all coming together and spent 8 weeks learning about second chance employment. We had online learning, there were video interviews, and then there were weekly facilitated trainings with myself and Ken Oliver, who's on this call today. Ken and I coordinated. Did you realize that, Ken? So in our weekly trainings, people learned about how second chance employment really is a matter of diversity, equity, and inclusion. And we talked about how you interview your candidates for these jobs, how you create an individualized assessment. And then our 8-week program wrapped up with people presenting their implementation plans. So in just that span of 8 weeks, the weekly online training self-paced, and then they had that opportunity to work with their peers and have a facilitated live training. So we have a couple other opportunities coming up this spring. We also have an accelerator program that's gonna get going soon. So we wanna make sure that we're connecting with you. And we also do consulting. So we would just love to get engaged with you. And if you go to our dkbfoundation.org website, you'll notice right on that first page, there's this place where you can put in your name and your contact info, because we do want to stay in touch with you and let you know about these opportunities. So again, May 3rd, that's when our next corporate cohort is starting. And give a holler if you want to find out if that's the right fit for you. I want to take some questions right now. Can we hear some questions? Any thoughts about the work of Dave's Killer Bread Foundation? Oh yeah, who is the point person for this program? So Genevieve Martin is our leader, and she's done a great job at connecting with people from different organizations, community-based organizations, and bringing in experts to either facilitate or to submit articles or videos in the training program. Is the program mainly for employers, or can service providers also participate? Service providers. So could you explain what service providers might mean? The program is designed for organizations, people who are part of an organization, or really anyone that wants to learn about how they can engage in more ethical hiring practices. Yeah, and it looks like programs for employers. You're welcome to share this program with those in your network. Interested in collaborations and recruitment that were vital in setting this up for success. I I'm going to think on what that is. What's been the response of part of the participating employers? The response last week when we finished up our 8-week program, it was incredibly positive. People learned a whole lot in that 8-week timeframe. A lot of it is practicing how to speak at their organization about second chance employment and practicing how to engage in interviews, in their corporate communications, learning how to take the mission, vision, and values of their organization and then create a statement that relates it to second chance employment and why it's the right fit for them. Is the 8-week program industry targeted? It's really not. I think anyone who is in a capacity to hire employees, I know that, you know, with my background in corporate training and instructional design, incredibly relevant. I thought that I was a really progressive employer and I thought I was doing the right things. And the more that I learn about this work, the more I realize there's so much more that we could be doing as far as making our workplaces more equitable. Specific industries such as big tech. We have worked with a lot of people in big tech. Those organizations tend to be really progressive and there are a lot of great work opportunities. And I know there's some people on the call that you're gonna probably hear from later who are doing this work in that space and we've worked with them. Currently the cohorts are interested companies regardless of their geographic location and our industries. Yeah. Yeah, our last group, we had people in very large organizations who are in, you know, finance, technology, food. Yeah, so I hope that you guys continue. If you have more questions for us, please do stay in touch and drop your name and email address, and we would love to talk to you. So thanks so much.
Thank you, and Parmeter, I apologize for mispronouncing your last name. Thank you so much. And thanks to all the folks at the Dave Skiller Bread Foundation for really leading this work. They've been really on the front lines of fair chance or second chance employment for a long time. So we definitely want to give credit where credit's due. And we look forward to collaborating with you and bringing more of your resources to our partners here in the Bay Area. Next, we have Dr. Genevieve Reimer, who is Manager of Advisory Services for the Center for Employment Opportunities, as well as Brian Martin, Special Project Manager for the SHRM Foundation. And together they're going to present on a new collaborative called Getting Talent Back to Work.
Yeah, thank you so much. And hi, everybody. Thanks for having me. As was mentioned, my name is Brian Martin, and I am the program manager for the SHRM Foundation's inclusion programs. So I'm incredibly excited to be here today, creating awareness for the Getting Talent Back to Work initiative, along with my colleague, Dr. Reimer. So for those who are not familiar with the SHRM Foundation, what we are is we operate as the 501c3 affiliate of SHRM, and our focus is really mobilizing the power of human resource professionals and the generosity of so many donors and partners to lead positive social change impacting work, workers, and the workplace. So simply put, we're really focused on making the world of work truly work for all. So from a strategic perspective then, one of our key priorities is influencing more inclusive workplaces, especially as we start to look at businesses who are rebuilding post COVID-19. We know that there's a lot of challenges there. We know that there's going to be a lot of opportunity, and we want to make sure that marginalized or often overlooked communities are considered as the economy rebuilds and the workplace rebuilds. So with that said, for a little over a year, the SHRM Foundation has worked to position itself to influence large-scale systemic change, especially within the HR community, for individuals with criminal and/or conviction records. And we did this by spearheading some initiatives that offer these populations a fair opportunity to gain and sustain employment. So in this effort, we really doubled down what we thought was important. And so thanks to incredible support from some of our incredible donors, which include the Lumina Foundation and partners, which include CEO, which you'll hear from here in a second, we developed new robust programming that was aimed to educate and equip HR professionals, people managers, and business leaders with the tools necessary to make changes to their DE&I strategies that included this population. So we have three programs that I really wanted to share with you all and let you guys just know that they're out there. Definitely push them out to your networks. And then I'd like to talk to you a little bit about how we went about making these. And so the first is our Getting Talent Back to Work self-assessment tool. I always say this is like an old BuzzFeed quiz that you might have taken when you were younger to figure out which 90s music video you were or whatever it might be. And what this is really a 10-question assessment that we have people who are interested take. And this assessment offers individuals a personalized report informed directly by their demographic information and interests. So if you're an organization looking to learn more about interviewing techniques for individuals with criminal records, then you can just identify those pieces and you'll get resources specifically for you. So this is a great first step for employers or for professionals learning how to reduce employment barriers affecting people with previous justice system experience. So far we've been really successful with this. We've had 401 HR professionals engage with this program and make a commitment towards hiring initiatives. The next program we have, which you may have heard of, is our Getting Talent Back to Work certificate program. So this is a one-of-a-kind program designed to, again, educate and equip HR professionals with the resources and tools they need to confidently hire from this pool of talent. So we're not just, in this training, we're not just giving employers the tools for just hiring or retaining these people. We're also providing an education for the background of the criminal justice system and ways to reduce some of the barriers that exist. And so this program will continue to be part of an educational journey that helps employers focus on their own biases, take action, and also capitalize on the value of employing individuals with criminal and/or conviction records. So again, we've been pretty successful with this. It's only been around since December, and we've had 257 HR professionals go through the program so far. And then our last tool is our Getting Talent Back to Work Digital Toolkit. So this acts a little bit like a living library of the latest research, resources, and tools that help dispel lingering misconceptions and provide practical tactics in building a more inclusive workplace. So this has been around for about a year, and over the last year, we've had over 21,000 unique HR professionals engage with these resources and implement them into their workplaces to provide more equitable opportunities for our Getting Talent Back to Work population. Now, it's one thing for SHRM to sit here and say, well, we're going to put out these resources and tell you that this is the right thing to do. But the SHRM Foundation recognizes that to create large-scale systemic change, we need experts in the field to help us. And so as these programs have gained that significant momentum that we are talking about, we have ensured the quality of these programs by working with partners and subject matter experts to make sure that the populations we serve are properly advocated for and that we truly understand and articulate the barriers that need to be overcome from an HR perspective. So one of those partners that I've worked with is the Center for Employing Opportunities. And specifically Dr. Reimer, who it's weird for me to call her Dr. Reimer. I've called her Jenna all these times. So this is new for me. But this partnership has been incredible for us and for me personally to learn more about the population and to make sure that our programs are robust enough to make sure that we are addressing every need within the population, whether it's collateral consequences to talent mobility and making sure that the right accommodations are available. So I'm going to kick it over to Jenna to explain a little bit more about this partnership and this program.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. Thank you, Brian, for kicking us off. It was so cool because 2 weeks ago, I was able to be a panelist and talk to you about my personal experience as a person with a criminal conviction, a job seeker at one time, and now an employee. And so now it's really cool that I can kind of put on my other hat and talk to you about how I have helped kind of create this content. As you all know, I work for the Center for Employment Opportunities, and we are the largest national reentry employer. We've been around for 30 plus years, and we have one mission, and that is to provide immediate employment to people on probation and parole supervision. We initially started as a project out of the Vera Institute of Justice, and we've grown to over 30 plus sites nationwide, and we serve about 10,000 people that have legal involvement every single year. And so while employment is still really our core service, we realize that there are other areas of work that we need to do in order to really improve or help people improve their lives within the broader community, which has led to this really amazing partnership with SHRM. So as an output of this partnership, we were able to develop two powerful and dynamic tools that has led to some really powerful culture shifts. And furthermore, create some opportunities for people like me with criminal convictions that are seeking employment. I like to say it's my COVID baby. I literally sat in the middle of COVID on the corner of my couch with my little puppy on my lap, and me and a colleague of mine, actually an MSW intern that I supervised, we wrote this curriculum. And I'm really proud of the finished product, but most importantly, we're really proud of the process that we took to get there. So I just want to talk about that for a second. Brian mentioned a couple of these, and I'll just touch on them again. The certificate program is free of charge, and it is available to anyone that is interested. So not only HR professionals, but employers, business folks, business owners, HR, whomever, it's interested to everyone. You don't have to be a member of SHRM in order to access his content. It consists of 10 hours of taped content that provides best practices regarding second chance employment. And it really moves the watcher from learning about the criminal legal system and appropriate language to use to thinking deeper about the talent lifecycle, including ways to recruit people with convictions, and also to think through talent development and mobility strategies. I think it's really important that not only do we want people to feel welcome in our place of employment, but we want them to have an opportunity to grow. So that's really important to us. I also think that what makes this content second to none is that not only was it developed for HR professionals and workforce stakeholders, but it was completely informed by people with criminal convictions. 100%. So every single script that we wrote, all of the best practices that we incorporated, the whole entire video was informed by people with criminal convictions. And so while it speaks to businesses, it really does so through the lens of formerly incarcerated people. And sprinkled throughout the video is live testimonies of people with criminal convictions that can really talk to why employment is so important to them. The wizard walks through employers, by a series of questions that Brian already talked about. And at the end of the questions, it prints out an individualized, customized report according to each person's specific and identified needs. This handy guide is also free of charge, and it takes a hands-on approach at creating more inclusive spaces for talent development and mobility for people with criminal convictions that are seeking employment. So how can you access it? I felt like so proud of myself right now by throwing all of the links into the chat while Brian was talking. So as soon as I'm done, I'll throw it in there again. But basically the hub is the Getting Talent Back to Work website. On the Getting Talent Back to Work website, you can find a plethora of resources. You can access the curriculum, you can access the wizard, you can sign the Getting Talent Back to Work pledge. And lastly, if you would love to learn more about the work, or you want to have a conversation with us, or you want to learn about how you can partner with us to think deeper about your employment practices, please feel free to reach out to me. I'd love to chat with you. You can find me on LinkedIn, and I'll also add my email to the chat box. And Brian, I'll pass it back over to you.
Yeah, and just to hammer home the point, Jenna has transformed the way that I view this work. I came here as a veteran interested in some of the veteran work we do here at the SHRM Foundation, and then Jenna has made this the the project and program that I love the most. I've learned so much, there's so much work to do. And I think that we're really starting to see momentum within the HR community. And so before we wrap up, I do just wanna point out that this is really just the start for the SHRM Foundation and its Getting Talent Back to Work initiative. We are currently in the process of conducting brand new research post-COVID-19. To understand the perceptions of HR professionals for this population and what barriers and biases need to be bridged, as well as what are some of the workplace barriers that exist for the population. And so we are looking at industries, we are looking at different levels within an organization. And so you'll see more on that soon, and that will inform future programming. And on top of that, we're working really closely with our chapters and councils and different community organizations to bring people together to really be a bridge that brings talent together with employers and HR professionals who have made a commitment here. And so what we need from you and what we ask for from you is engagement with the program, feedback when you can provide it. We want to make sure that we are engaged with people who are passionate about this work and that can serve, I think, as a benefit and resource as we continue to build out new content, new material, and really try to drive some type of large-scale systemic change. So I think that's it, if you don't have anything else, and we can kick it back.
Thank you, Brian. And thank you, Dr. Reimer. Dr. Reimer is being very, very modest. I'm sure that all of you probably got it, you know, could tell. I want to say just a couple of things about Dr. Reimer. She is one of the founders of the program Unchained Scholars at the University of Southern California, which is a support program for formerly incarcerated students at that institution. And she is also very instrumental in getting, I believe it was the graduate school at the University of Southern California to remove the box that asked about any prior convictions. So Dr. Reimer is one of the leaders in this work, and we want to call her by her rightful title, Dr. Reimer. So thank you so much for all the work that you do, and this is an incredible opportunity. Getting Talent Back to Work, it's a great collaboration between SHRM and CEO. Last but not least, it brings me great pleasure to introduce our next presenters. His name is Ken Oliver. He is Director of Business Development for the CROP organization, and he's going to talk about an upskilling, reskilling opportunity for formerly incarcerated people.
Good morning, everybody. It's hard to follow Dr. Reimer and Brian, but it's a pleasure to be able to do so. I appreciate all of you. I guess the first thing I'd like to say is just give honor and thanks to the Rising Scholars Network, Kelly, Damani, Carrie, and of course, Lauren Bell, and then also the proximate leadership of people like Jenna and Carmen Meeks and KD, who are on this call today, because it wouldn't be possible to have the type of information that we have if it wasn't for the proximate leadership and the facilitation by the Rising Scholars Network. So I appreciate you all in the audience sharing space with us today. It means a lot to push this initiative forward as a collective. I guess the first thing I'd like to say is that I myself am a proximate leader. I spent more than 24 years in prison, more than 9 years in solitary confinement. And when I was released unceremoniously in 2019, what I found was a landscape that didn't have a lot of programs for people coming out of prison to get upskilled or reskilled, if you will. And as I began my work at Legal Services for Prisons of Children, in the policy landscape, I started to recognize that there were a lot of bridges that needed to be built between the skills gap of what happened in the prison environment versus what was happening out here in society. Bottom line is that there weren't a lot of market-driven skill sets being taught in the prison environment. And when we arrive out into society to look for a job, most of the jobs that we're able to get are low wage, high labor, and very little opportunity to thrive. I set out to change that. If there's not a table, sometimes you have to build your own. So I joined the CROP organization to do just that. And as we begin to look at the landscape of skill set development, we emphatically came to the conclusion that the future of work is technology. I had the benefit of testifying on a panel for the governor's Future of Work, and we spent a lot of time talking about the role that technology will play in the next 10 to 15 years in this country. It already plays a big role. But 85 million jobs will be lost by 2025 to automation or technology. and 97 million jobs will be created based on people who have that technology skill set. One of the difficulties for people coming home from incarceration is that there is not access to technology, unless of course you've smuggled in a cell phone, but that's another story. So when people come home from prison, the fact that they don't know how to work a smartphone, the fact that they don't have technology skills, the fact that they don't know how to work Gmail or Outlook really puts people behind the eight ball when it comes to employment opportunities. So what CROP has set out to do is to build a technology-based reskilling workforce development program specifically for formerly incarcerated people. Everybody in the CROP leadership team is a formerly incarcerated person. So we really set out to be intentional about developing a holistic reentry program that takes somebody from the first day out of prison all the way until they can have the keys to their own apartment or home with a livable wage job. It doesn't do much for you if you're making $15 or $16 an hour and you're living in the Bay Area or Los Angeles, because it's very difficult to pay rent in those cities if you don't have livable wage. So what CROP has done is we've developed our first B2B tech sales program, which launches on May the 3rd. We had our kickoff event last Friday, which Damani was present and Lauren Bell was present from Checker. And this program is going to be facilitated largely in part by Code Tenderloin and our partnership with Checker. And this partnership would not have been possible without Lauren's wonderful dedication to our mission over there at Checker. She has been really intentional in the space up here in the Bay Area and across California and really across the country about championing the mission that Checker has to dedicate a certain percentage of talent to fair chance talent. So I want to throw hats off to her and the partnership with Checker and our ability to deliver this to formerly incarcerated people. I'm going to try to share my screen for people who are looking for opportunity or want to share it with their networks. This is the flyer for the Ready for Life kickoff event. We'll be teaching personal leadership development. We'll have professional skill development, or what some people call soft skills. We'll also have a digital boot camp and digital training to get people certified in digital skills. We also have partnered with Beneficial State Bank for a financial literacy component, where we will be stipending participants $1,000 a month, a portion of which will go to build their credit profile with MasterCard, who has agreed to match the funds that people save. And then we've also developed a housing first and last month's rent program for when people graduate the program or graduate from a transitional facility, they'll have a few thousand dollars to put down on a place. We also have developed an employer development program, largely in part of the work that people like Sherm and Dave's Killer Bread have done in the space. And so we want to work with employers hand in hand over long periods of time to develop a DEI strategy that is inclusive of formerly incarcerated people. We also are very intentional about having a support network of formerly incarcerated people, positive peer-to-peer mentoring and network. That's one of the major factors of recidivism when people fall through the cracks and feel like they don't have a support network. So we're very intentional about that. We also are giving participants a free laptop when they're admitted to the program. So they'll have a free laptop that's donated by Dell. We're proud of that partnership. And we'll have the stipend, as I mentioned already. The only thing that we ask is that participants have some type of justice involvement, either a misdemeanor or a felony conviction that has hampered them in employment in the past. You don't necessarily have to be formally incarcerated. It's a part-time program that works from 5 to 9 in the evening, Monday through Friday. We will have guest speakers. We have several people from LinkedIn who will be participating and facilitating some of the discussions. It's going to just be an all-around great program. And then at the end of this program, we're going to be very intentional about placing people with tech companies in Silicon Valley and the Bay Area for people to earn that livable wage employment that we talked about. Even though the kickoff event happened last Friday, we will be taking applications until April the 2nd. And you can find the application and find out more information as far as details of the program if you go to our website, croporganization.org. Lauren and Damani, if you don't mind dropping that in the chat, I would appreciate it. We're open for questions. I'll also put my email in the chat. If you know somebody that's justice involved or somebody that's looking for a change to get into a higher wage employment situation, we'll be training people for 6 months and doing our best to facilitate pathways for people in the tech sector. So I appreciate that. That's all I have, Damani.
Thank you, Ken. And as Ken likes to say, CROP is building the Stanford University of reentry programs. So we expect to hear some big things coming from Ken and his team over at Crop. Thank you so much. If you do have any questions for Ken or for anyone, please drop those questions in the chat and somebody will respond. We want to take some time now. I know we've been presenting a lot of information, but what we would like to do now is to transition into a breakout session where we can actually hear from you, hear from some of the participants on this call, because we believe in collaboration. We believe that there are a lot of people who are participating in this event who have great ideas. And our goal is to not leave the discussion here with this webinar series, but really to continue this conversation. And we'll be exploring different ways to do that. But we do have several themed breakout rooms. In fact, I'll let Carrie, if you would be so kind as to share that with our audience. We're very fortunate to have Katie Dixon from Legal Aid at Work, who is going to be facilitating a breakout room on fair chance policy. We have the aforementioned Dr. Genevieve Reimer from CEO, who's going to talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion strategy. Carmen Meeks from the Anti-Recidivism Coalition and Ken Kropp will be talking about reskilling and upskilling opportunities for formerly incarcerated people. And then we have representing community colleges, none other than Kelly Nadler from the Rising Scholars Network. And then last but not least, we have our very own Lauren Bell from Checker, who will be talking about strategies for recruiting fair chance talent. So we encourage you to choose a breakout room that is most appealing. And then we'll give, let's say, maybe about 10 minutes, maybe 10 to 15 minutes for discussion. And then we'll come back and we'll wrap up. And that's why we are going to use this webinar series really as a kind of a launching pad for other future conversations. And we will be in touch with all of you regarding next steps and how we can continue this collaboration, because obviously there's a lot more work that needs to be done, and we can't do this work in silos. We have to work together. Employers have to work with community-based organizations, which have to work with educational institutions, workforce development boards, the whole nine. And we want to build the ecosystem that will, you know, produce opportunities for formerly incarcerated people in the workplace. I want to thank all of our partners, the Rising Scholars Network, Checker Inc., the Crop Organization, the Anti-Recidivism Coalition, Katie Dixon from Legal Aid at Work, Center for Employment Opportunities, SHRM, Dave's Killer Bread Foundation. Thank you so much for contributing to this event. I hope I'm not leaving anyone out. Am I leaving anyone out, team? Sometimes I'm guilty of doing that at times.
How about yourself?
Oh.
Don't forget about self-love. Right.
Well, thank you. Appreciate that. Bay Area, yeah. My name is, again, Damani Fisher. This was a vision that I had with, Lauren. We had a conversation months ago. It was a Friday night. We got together through LinkedIn and said, hey, we need to put this on. And there, that kind of led us down this path. Mm-hmm. So again, we're looking to continue this conversation. We're going to provide you with recordings of all three webinars for you to review and to share with your network. So let's all be sure to stay in touch. Let's keep working together, keep collaborating. Carrie Portis, thank you, thank you, thank you. Carrie Portis, my colleague at the Bay Area Community College Consortium, she's the one who is behind the scenes and knows how to do all the Zoom logistics, and we could not have done this without your critical support. So thank you so very much. We'll be in touch. Thank you.